Well, good morning. It's time for us to talk about problem-based learning. And the title of this session is Problem-Based Learning, a Teaching Method, and So Much More. And I think it's a good opportunity for us to do some investigating into what PBL can do for us in our classes and let us know why it works the way that it does. First of all, I wanted to tell you that what we're trying to get out of this today is to talk about a PBL event, what it is and how is it different from other approaches. We want to talk about how to link learning to life using effective problem scenarios. We want to talk about how it will empower us and our learners. It's a powerful way to encourage learning. Then we want to focus on how to implement PBL. So we're going to look at the 8 essential elements of a PBL. And we're going to talk about some learning objectives and how to meet those, and assessments. And finally, we want to talk about our role as a PBL facilitator, because it's dramatically different from what we're used to as in terms of giving lecture. And this is what we're talking about. There is a typical zone of interaction with our content where we have at the center of our understanding the content that we are going to teach. So if it's history, we approach it from the historical perspective. We have the instructor, the student, and we might have a situation in life that we're trying to address, but we're doing it by starting at the content area. So we begin to teach history, for example, or math or science or whatever it is, and then we expect that to apply to a problem that someone will meet in real life. This is what we're trying to do when we do that. We are beginning with the content area and then moving to the context. So we're starting with history or math or science or English or whatever content area we're talking about. And this is the problem with most traditional instruction. It starts here and then we expect it to apply to some situation in real life. Problem-based learning, on the other hand, takes into account what students know on the front end and takes into account the context within which they are learning. So not just what they know, but who they are, what affects them as a learner, what is their culture, what is their background, what are their understandings at present. And we start with that, and then we take a problem that exists in life in the context in which it is found, and then we match content to that. So the learner moves from this previous understanding of what a whole is to the parts, and then they reconstruct what a new whole would look like. So this is the whole part, whole model, and that's what problem-based learning is all about. It's backing up and establishing context before we establish the importance of our content. So, in PBL, we have this arrangement where the problem becomes the center of attention as opposed to the content. Content serves the problem as opposed to it being the other way around. Notice that the student bubble has gotten larger because problem-based learning is more student-focused and more student-led than traditional instruction. And the instructor is off to the side because the instructor acts as a kind of a learning coach as opposed to being a giver of knowledge. As we go forward, we're thinking that PBL probably will look like this after all has been said and done, that the problem that we are addressing spreads and subsumes all the other circles that we have involved. Student is still the largest part. The instructor is important and the content is important, but it's all within the context of a problem and what that means. So how do we teach? A common misconception about problem-based learning is that we only do it through written scenarios. That is the most common application of a PBL, but the reality is that we're going to use any teaching method that works. Typically, we try to find a way to address visual, auditory, and kinesthetic learning at the same time. So you might, for example, find that At a certain point in your PBL experience, it's important for us to stop and give a lecture, a small point of time where everybody gets stumped. You have to stop and say, okay, this is a good moment for us to have what we call just-in-time instruction. Just at the moment in time that you need that knowledge, you get that knowledge. So it's just in time as opposed to just in case it's on the test. So in all learning, we tend to sense, integrate, and act. So we use our senses to engage with the world, and we integrate that into what we already know, and then we make actions based on that. So again, in PBL, it's often thought that the only thing that you produce are products that are used in daily life. Well, that's true to a certain point. But in learning, an action can be the writing of an analysis, a paper, or some other form of action. It's just what works is what is important for us. So I don't want to get hung up on the fact or the idea that problem-based learning is merely experiential. It is academic as well. So when we looked at how to think about how problem-based learning works, we thought about the different models of learning that are important, and we begin to see some commonalities. So in Kolb's model of experiential learning, you see concrete experience, reflective observation, abstract conceptualization, and active experimentation. That looks a lot like Zuhl's four pillars of learning: gathering data, reflecting, creating, and testing. That looks a lot like the scientific method: forming hypotheses, doing experimentation, getting data and results, and then concluding and publishing. So there is a cycle that's involved in all those approaches to learning. And it's important for us to acknowledge that and to say that there has got to be this sort of a curricular piece that's reflected in our PBL design. So how are we teaching? Remember, visual, auditory, kinesthetic, anything that works, we're going to do that at any point during the PBL process. You can stop and have students draw something. You know, it just depends on what you need at the moment to activate the learning. Now here is a little diagram of something that is very important in problem-based learning, and that is, as a PBL designer, you are creating what we call a solution space. That is that there's this complex problem that's made up of a lot of different pieces and elements and sub-problems, issues, tasks. It's a messy thing. It's life. But you know, as a PBL designer, that your students are going to go in at one point and they're going to come out at one point. And the idea for you as a PBL designer is to create a rich context within which your students will navigate, and they'll interact with as much of that learning space as possible before they come out at the other end. And that typically is how it works. You have a lot of messing around in the solution space, and students often think that there are no bounds. They feel like it's very free and open and they can do anything that they want to, and they don't realize that, yes, there are boundaries. You just created a big box for them to operate within. So it's not out of the box thinking totally. It's just that it's a box that is large. So you have a lot of control. In fact, one of the complaints about PBL is that instructors lose control of the learning. But in truth, if you've done this properly, you have more control than ever, because students think, they feel that they are exercising autonomy. And they are. They can go anywhere they want to within the box that you created. So it's all what works. So here are the elements. We've talked a little bit about the background and what makes PBL work. And here are the pieces of a problem-based learning scenario that you have to have in order to make it happen. So there are eight of them. And if you don't have all eight, you don't have a fully functioning PBL unit. So notice that the biggest thing is the problem. That's the most important part. And you have to have a problem that is relevant to life, that's authentic, that's interesting, that is contextualized, it's rich, it's got a lot of interesting handles that students can grab onto so they can approach it from a lot of different directions. It's got to be a really rich, good problem for it to work. You're always going to have an introduction. You're always going to have a moment where you talk about the problem in a way that will hook the interest of the learner. So when you're creating PBL, you're going to have two documents. One is for the facilitator and one is for the learner. And in the facilitator notes, you're going to have a rich, full introduction that tells about why this is important. And it situates the problem in real life. In the learner's portion, it may be just a few sentences that says, this is a problem about so-and-so. And a person who is facing a situation that they don't know what to do about. So you move from that to learning objectives. So with facilitators, you have a list of learning objectives that are built on a hierarchy so that you have the comprehension of the learning, you move to the application, you move to synthesis, and you move to an effective objective at the end. So you have those stacked learning objectives. For students, you don't show those learning objectives because the whole point is for them to muddle around in that solution space. You'll show those learning objectives after it's all over. They identify learning objectives along the way, and you guide that. You guide that through the use of guiding questions. Guiding questions are open-ended. In your role as a facilitator, you might ask a question that is probing, that encourages thought, and it's a lot about process. You have a lot of process questions in problem-based learning. Have you considered all the angles? What was your thinking like when you decided that this was important? What made you think so-and-so? So you get them moving through the solution space with the guiding questions that you use. In PBL, there are always resources, and you have an option. If you want to have a, a PBL that is more controlled, you provide the resources that students use to solve the problems. If you want to have a PBL that is open-ended, you don't. They go out and they find their own resources. And then you, as an instructor, can evaluate the usefulness of those resources, and you might have a guiding question about that. Do you think that you have found the proper resources in order to solve this problem? And in the whole PBL process, as they're working through this, if a facilitator ever speaks up, it's a red flag. It should be a real moment for them to stop and say, wait a minute, they never say anything unless it's really important. So if you notice that they're not getting good resources, it's your job to gently nudge them back on track. Generally speaking, PBL groups will self-correct. We've seen that. I've done this for 20-something years, and we've seen that consistently, that if you allow people to work in a group and they're taking it seriously, they will self-correct back to where they need to be. There's always a product. There has to be something that you're creating, and it does relate to what's happening in real life. So for doctors, it might be a diagnosis. For teachers, it's a lesson plan or a parent-teacher form. Whatever it is that happens in real life is the product that you're going to have for the solution to the problem. We do have to consider time, and you can have PBLs that last anywhere from 1 hour to a whole year. It just depends on the scope of the problem that you want to present and how much you want to dig into it and how many times you want to revisit it. Problem-based learning is built on a spiral curriculum. So it's do, experiment, test, hypothesize, drop down, do again, or revisit it on a different level of complexity. For example, we did one once that was on the oil shortage, and we presented that in three different stages: elementary level, middle school and high school. And so students who were coming up through the program could experience that at a very elementary level. And then again in middle school, they'd see the same issue framed differently, more in a more complex manner. And then high school, they really got into the politics and everything else about the oil and the shortage of oil. So then you have assessments, and we're going to talk a little bit about what makes a good assessment in PBL. But there are assessments, and generally speaking, they're mostly formative. Problem-based learning does not lend itself to a lot of summative assessment because learning is always ongoing. It's always taking place. And even what you would think of as a summative assessment, like a performance or a presentation, can be graded, but if you do it in a PBL fashion, it is done in front of experts who may have feedback on the effectiveness of the presentation, and so it becomes another learning experience on the spot. So learning with PBL never stops, just as it does not stop in life. But you do have these moments of assessment that you can use, and we'll talk about that. So there are roles and responsibilities, and when you think of the roles of how to do a PBL session, you must think about your role as a learning coach and guide or a monitor. And more we are getting to the point that we are thinking of ourselves as facilitators or even counselors. You know, the idea that you have to be able to help someone through the learning process and teach them how to learn. It's not so much that you are a lecturer anymore, although as I said before, you can stop and give information when you need to. We just don't want to make it the centerpiece of your instruction. Let me say about lecturing too that there's nothing wrong with great lecture, but it better be great. One of the most effective ways of teaching is through storytelling, which is basically lecture. But it's very interesting and engaging, and it keeps students involved. So if you're lecturing, you have to make sure that it's a great lecture. In PBL, students take on the role of leading the discussion and keeping notes and doing research. So there's a quarterback who leads the discussion, and the quarterback is also a researcher. A scribe who takes notes, the scribe is also a researcher, and then the rest of the group are all researchers. So that role of quarterback can rotate among group members as you go through and do different PBLs, so can the role of scribe. But remember that everything is situated around the solving of a common problem. And the facilitator's role is, the instructor's role is that of facilitator standing off to the side. And again, what happens is the quarterback will read the problem, everybody listens to the problem, and then they go through a process of brainstorming to reach some ideas about what they know, what they need to know, and where they're going to go to get more information. I'll show you that in a minute. That is what we call the PBL learning grid. So they approach the problem, the quarterback reads it to them, everybody sits there and they listen to it, say in scene one, and then they focus on what do you know. They list just the facts under the key points on the PBL learning grid. So this begins to stretch down and down as you type into it. But what you get are a listing of key facts that appear in that scene. Then, from scene one, you move to what do you need to know, where you list the knowledge, the relevant information or skills that you need to address the problem. So in scene one, you would say, well, we know this, what we need to know is this. We know that, what we need to know is that. You know, so you move from column one to column two in the process. Then you go to scene two and you repeat that process. And you do it with however many scenes you have. And typically there are three scenes in a standard PBL. At any moment, you can drop down, at any moment on the learning grid, you can drop down and put in some analysis and ideas for solutions. So you determine what is the problem and what is the solution. So you may have a student in the group that has a flash of inspiration and says, I think it's this. And you say, okay, that's great. That's not a fact or something that we need to know. It is an analysis or an idea for a solution. We're going to put it down here for now and see where that goes. So we don't forget it. We put everything up here. It's a brainstorming document. After you've done all three scenes, put in all the analysis, identified what you think the problem is and what you think the solution might be, you move to the third column, where you create a list of topics that come from the items in step two, which is, remember, what we think we need to know. So you take those topics, you combine items from column two that need to be combined, or they stand alone, and you make a list over here of things that you're going to research in order to inform the solution. So this is a way for us to develop learning tasks, and students in the group will take a learning task and they'll go out and they'll research that and they'll come back to the group. So they'll take the topics. Everyone gets one. Sometimes you get two. It depends on how many topics there are and how complex they are and who can do what. And they go out and they do the research on those, and then they bring those back to inform the rest of the group. And they do that in the form of research briefs. So there's subject area that you go out and research, you come back with something that you can hand out to the rest of the group and say, I have become expert to a certain degree on this subject area, and I'm going to bring you up to speed on what I learned. So this is a modification of the jigsaw process that we often use in our regular teaching. So, moving to assessments. Once you have done all that, you have a research brief, that's a great place to do a formative assessment, because you as an instructor are looking for a way to gauge how effective this is going on, how effective it's the PBL is working. And so we have that as a formative assessment. So you're going to be able to say, okay, I think that they're doing well because of the breadth and the depth and the scope of the research that they did and how they shared it. You can also do some checks for understanding along the way. You can do exit tickets. You can check on discussion boards to see how they're doing. You can also look at the way the group is working together to tell how involved they are and how engaged they are in the process. And there are some summative assessments that you can do. For example, PBL is really big in the medical profession, and there are the boards that they eventually take. That's the big summative assessment. In the teaching profession, there's the examinations for licensure, and for us, it's the EdTPA that we know we have to pass. So those are big time summative assessments. But objective tests, we must know that in PBL, objective tests do not often or do not always measure learning very well, because the learning is not in an application setting. Going back to the medical profession, we have found that over the years that PBL has benefit in terms of the doctors getting out into practice and saying, well, I have experience with simulations and scenarios that I wouldn't have gotten if I just learned about something. So I feel more comfortable, more prepared as a practitioner, but I didn't do any better on the boards than somebody who was learning about it. So objective tests measure a certain type of knowledge. Often they measure what we think of as school knowledge or book knowledge. And that doesn't get to the heart of PBL. PBL is about how well you do in practice. So learning never stops with PBL. You can have examples of learning in a real setting, performance in a real setting. So we've had middle schoolers who created ideas for business competitions, and they would interact over the course of the curriculum with experts like lawyers and architects and zoning commissioners and others who would give them information that they would use in the development of their idea. And then those very people would come in and serve on a panel, and when it came time for the students to present their ideas. So it's performance in a real setting that makes PBL have a kind of a reality to it. We get those experts come in from the field. I know one PBL that we did in a local town here was where students were asked what they would do with a park area that was undeveloped. You know, how would they make that a place where kids could go and have fun? And they came up with all these different ideas. And what we were interested in was that they come up with the planning process and all the elements of marketing and financing and all the things that we wanted, the skills that we wanted them to have in their learning objectives. And they did that. No matter what choice they made for things to go in that park area, they had to go through the same planning process that we had asked them to do. So they were getting real experience doing that. And then they presented that to the local commissioners, and then they took it a step further. They went into the summer where they actually started to implement some of the ideas that they had, and the kids could go out there and work in the park and make it happen. So that's how PBL can create a bridge from classroom to community, and that's a real powerful piece of it. Rubrics. PBL is all about rubrics. So we have to be able to measure the efficacy of a particular piece of the PBL, and we have to have a way to do that. And I have handed out an example of a research brief rubric, which is what we use in the teaching training program here at MTSU. And that is just for you to take. And then in addition, I gave you also a copy of the bubbles and a copy of the PBL learning grid. So, but then I gave you this. And this is called a seat at the table. And I wanted to give you an example of a PBL that you could actually look at and understand that this is a very elementary, a very simple example, because it's a PBL for a workshop that I did for MT Engage. And it has all the elements in here. It has a table of contents that shows all the 8 elements, and that gives you that you can look at and think about and how it's done. So if you look on, I want to just touch base on this. If we were to do this, this is called a seat at the table, and I wanted to just read this to you and give you a feel for what we would do and how we would do it. It goes like this. Today I had lunch at Sylvan Park Restaurant. It's a small meat and three restaurant in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. The layout of the tables in the dining room is such that everyone is seated close together. It's impossible not to overhear conversations at the nearby tables, and today I overheard one that made my ears perk up. The restaurant appeals to people from all walks of life, from blue-collar workers in work clothes to professionals in business attire. The table next to me, only a couple of feet from my elbow, was occupied by 4 men. When they first came in, I had noticed that they wore nice clothes, dress shirts, ties, slacks, the whole thing. Right away, I figured that they were professionals of some sort. But it was their conversation that really stood out to me. The students that come from MTSU are just not prepared to go to work for me, one complained. I had one that couldn't even read a spreadsheet of my monthly P&L, much less create a spreadsheet using Excel, you know, one that can generate charts and graphs. When I asked her about it, she said that the university didn't teach that. I don't get it. What are they teaching them over there? I know what you mean, chimed in another. Not only do I have to train them to read my lab instruments, but they don't seem to have the same attitude about work that I had when I got my start. I have to monitor them all the time to make sure that they get their work done and done right. The conversation continued along those lines, with one after the other talking about MTSU students, and they were not used to working until the job was done, or taking too much time off, or dressing unprofessionally. One fellow said that students just didn't seem to understand how to function in the workplace. I can't give them any important tasks to do because they don't know how to work together with other workers, he stated. And forget about leadership skills, another complained. They can't lead. They want me to tell them exactly what to do. One man mused, I should have known better when I hired the last one. He didn't even have a professional-looking resume, but he seemed like a nice kid, and he graduated with honors, so I took a chance. I still think he's a nice kid, and I think he'll be okay eventually once I get him trained in how to put together a professional ad proposal, but I wish he'd had those skills already. I have to admit that I was perplexed and a little put out. I wanted to speak up and defend our programs of study because I know very well that we do teach these skills. But it would have been rude to interrupt their lunch, and besides, I thought, their perception is their reality. I left the restaurant wondering what I could do to change their perceptions, and I was worried too. What if I had an even harder task to do? What if I had to change the reality as well? So, if we were doing this, I would say, what do we know? And you would say,
we know you had lunch at Sylvan Park.
I had lunch at Sylvan Park.
Four guys.
The four guys were next to me.
They are business professionals.
They're business professionals.
The tables are close, so it's hard not to overhear.
Right, tables are close.
They were complaining about MTSU students they've hired.
They were complaining about the MTSU students.
They feel the students aren't prepared for the workplace.
They feel the students aren't prepared.
They have to train them.
They have to train them, yes.
And they have a good work ethic.
And they didn't have a good work ethic. Okay, so taking that, what do we need to know?
What profession are they in?
What profession are they in? Okay. Do we have any idea about any of that?
Yes.
Yes.
We do, for one, anyway.
The lab person.
There's a lab person there. And then there's another one.
Advertising.
So there's a couple that we might know. But yes, we do need to know more about these professions. What else do we want to know?
Well, I want to know what the monthly P&L is that needs a spreadsheet.
Right. What's a P&L? Anything else?
What leadership skills exactly they want the student, the employees to have.
Right. So that would be a thing that I would want to know more about. What do you know now about leadership skills? What kind of things do you think that you would want to know more about?
Self-motivation.
Mm-hmm.
Working on a team.
Working on a team, yeah. So those are some of the things that you'd want to know. So let me ask you, what do you think the problem is in this scenario? This is just a short one, but what do you think is the problem?
Students or recent graduates are not prepared for the workforce.
Okay. Y'all agree with that?
I think we're preparing them, but it may not be in the right. It must not be in the right areas, because these men were talking about it. It would be good if you could get the men together and to formulate. What would you like to see? What is it that you would like to see these kids know that they don't know?
Mm-hmm.
So maybe the problem is that the university does not know what the workforce needs. Right. And so they're...
And that was what I was saying. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we have several items that we have talked about that we need to know. Are we satisfied with the statement of the problem? If we're satisfied with that, let me ask you, who would want to research on leadership? Vanya, would you want to do that? This is where we would break up these tasks and do the research and then come back and say, these are the things that we've learned and this is how it relates to that problem. And then our product in this particular scenario was for the workshop folks. This was, again, a 60-minute scenario. The workshop folks were to create a plan for including work and life skills in a college curriculum. They would do that in small groups, and then they were to come out in large groups and share that with each other and then discuss the elements of the plan that they had come up with and give ideas and share those ideas about how to change the college curriculum to make it more suitable for preparing students for careers once they graduated. And the goal overall of this whole workshop was to show how you can use problem-based learning to teach problem-based learning and to get our workshop participants used to the idea of how to think like a problem-based learning person would think. So we wanted them ultimately to use PBL in the MT Engage program on campus to try to make those connections between college curriculum and career. And it was very successful, I must say. Are there any questions? All right. Thank you very much.